coast to coast.
Hey there, kiddies. It's the Loveline. I'm Adam Carolla. That is Dr. Drew over there. Phone number 1-800-LOVE-191. Fax number 310-854-4455. Dr. Drew, board certified physician, addiction medicine specialist, and sporting some gel in his hair tonight.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
It's all cut shorter.
Yeah, you got a real James Brolin look.
Is that what that is?
Yeah.
I got to get the beard going, too. Didn't he have a beard still?
He may have shaved it. You're thinking of
20 years ago?
Maybe 25. No, I don't know if Brolin still... No, Brolin shaved his beard. That's right. Babs had him do it.
That's right. That's
yeah,
right.
So you're looking very hip, very
Thank you.
Fresh.
Thank you.
Yeah. Smelling good. All right, no guests tonight. Tonight, the guest is the love that the two hosts find between each other. Right, Drew?
The guest we welcome in.
That's right.
Oh, sorry. Just took off.
The love?
Yeah.
Oh, I thought you broke wind. I thought it was some kind of code. Eric?
Yeah.
You're 19. What's up?
Yeah, I was fingering my girlfriend, and I've done this before, but this time I got a lot deeper than I usually do.
Mm-hmm.
And I felt like a weird bump, like a real firm lump type, I don't know, something inside of her.
Mm-hmm. All right, Eric, hold on 1 second.
Okay.
Junior college, Adam?
No college. No college.
Okay.
That bump was a button on the bed. Your finger had actually gone out her asshole, Eric.
The bump, as you described it, is her cervix.
Is it?
Yeah. I suggest you just pick up a little, maybe go on the web and look at an anatomy textbook. About the end, about the end of your third finger, if you put it in deep, you will feel the cervix.
Yeah.
And it feels like a little, it's about the size of the OK sign if you put your thumb and index finger around the OK. And then it's got a little, if you notice a little indentation in the center, that's the hole that the baby would come out.
Is it?
Young Eric. If yeah.
You know, the cervix to me...
Give me the pictures.
The few times, I've never touched it with my penis, but I have hit it with my hand before.
Mm-hmm.
And it always, always think of a, you know, a little chicken liver that comes in the giblet package when you buy a whole chicken? You ever see what a chicken liver looks like? That's what it reminds me of.
It is that consistency. It's firm, but mushy.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, chicken liver.
Yeah.
John?
Yes?
You're 22.
I am.
What's up?
My fiance has a thing of screaming really loud when we have sex,
mm-hmm.
and it gets right in my ear, and it actually makes it very painful and makes me stop enjoying sex in general.
What does she scream?
She just screams. It's like a bloody scream.
Bloody scream?
Yeah, the best thing I can compare it to is, you ever see Blade Runner? When Daryl Hannah got shot at the end of Blade Runner, that's what it reminds me of.
I see. Well, at least Ed Asner wasn't shot. I mean, at least you get to picture Daryl Hannah.
Is there any way you could change positions so her mouth isn't right by your ear?
We've tried that, but I guess my ears are very susceptible to loud noises because whenever police sirens go by.
Why don't you wear earplugs when you guys are having sex?
Well, I'm just wondering if there's anything that could be done.
I would think the more disturbing thing would be that you might sort of alert the surrounding community to what you're up to.
Yeah, that's another problem.
It's kind of embarrassing.
I don't want to share with the world.
Yeah, a little embarrassing.
What I'm doing.
Yeah.
So, or
well, that's not
calling the police.
Not a bad calling card. I mean, hey, I'm giving another chick an orgasm. Mark that on your calendar. Hey, John?
Yeah.
She's having the orgasm, right?
Yes, she is.
And... do you live in an apartment?
I rent a room in a house.
No, worse.
Ooh.
Yeah.
Do the neighbors complain?
Old farmers living upstairs.
Neighbors complain?
No, but my roommate has.
Uh-huh.
Okay, is she in a place emotionally where you could put a pillow over her head and she wouldn't know it?
Well, maybe wouldn't mind it?
Or wouldn't mind it?
We've tried that, but she moves around and keeps screaming. I was wondering what causes this, because what she says the reason why is because it's a release.
Yeah. For her.
No,
I understand.
No kidding.
Why don't... what position are you in? Are you on top of her?
I'm on the bottom.
You're on the bottom. And mm-hmm. She's up top.
Mm-hmm.
That's the way she has her orgasm.
Mm-hmm.
So she has to sort of stifle herself. Can you give her a you know, wooden spoon to chomp down on or something? I mean, she's aware of it, right?
Yes, she is.
She'd take a hand towel and tie it up with a rubber band and let her bite down on it or something.
Okay.
I don't know what you're going to be able to do.
I
want to
interview this woman. I mean, what is going through her mind that it like she can't or is unwilling to kind of contain this a little bit?
Women can't do that sometimes.
Yeah, but this is, she's shrieking, you think, and she's sort of trying to help him contain it. What is that?
I don't know. That's what I was calling you about, because it somewhat worried me, too.
Why?
Why would it worry me?
Well, that she's a little nutty, right?
She somewhat is, but that's one of the appealing factors about
her. Yeah.
Your appeal, you find that attractive.
Mm-hmm.
The nuttier chicks are, the more they enjoy sex. I don't know why God did that to them. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
But man, they orgasm. Like, you know, a chick who's totally emotionally together, she orgasms like, oh yeah, oh yeah, that was good. And the nutball chick's like, yeah, oh, no! And they start like screaming weird stuff, and they're yelling out their dad's name.
Nice.
Yeah. I mean, I know that from the movies.
So,
hey, John, listen, here's what you need to tell her.
Okay.
You know what you're doing, and I don't want to freak the neighbors out. So seriously, here's a little washcloth. I'm going to fold it up into a couple of squares, and when the time comes, just put it in your mouth and chomp down on it.
Okay.
I don't know what else to do about it.
I mean, that's about it.
If she's on top, he can't really get up and...
He can wear earplugs. They could have some sort of sealed room. They put, you know, out, you know, in the car or something. God knows.
No, let her bite
control
down on
it, I would
towel.
Think so. Hey, listen, yeah. I wanted to shout out to Tucson, where we are actually looking for the mason jar guy.
Mm-hmm.
The original guy with the anus, how do you say this?
The anus the size of a mason jar?
Yes, that guy, we want him back.
Yeah, do you think that guy's going to call, or do you think 300 guys say they're that guy?
I can tell when it's that guy. I know that voice, so okay. I'm going to know if it's him.
Butthole the size of a mason jar.
I bet, yes, butthole. In fact, that's the way he put it. Yes, nice. All mm-hmm. class. And I'll know it if it's him. I recognize that voice anywhere. And mm-hmm. They actually want to make him a promotional vehicle. So it'll be
no.
Right? Yes.
No, we're just hoping he calls in so we can have him arrested.
No.
All right. I think that guy is dead or in prison.
Well, people probably know him. And
He's a fat guy who wears the hockey jersey.
You met him. Yeah. You met him when you were down at KFMA.
I was down in Tucson, and
yeah.
I met him.
Yeah.
What a lovely, lovely, lovely...
lad.
Lovely piece of ass lad that guy was. Yeah. Nick?
Yeah.
You're 16. What's up?
I made up my call, but I just wanted to get in and talk to you, Adam. You're the funniest man alive.
Why, thank you.
Where are you calling from?
Kansas.
Whereabouts?
Topeka.
Mm. Okay.
Good follow up there, Drew.
Mm. Mm. Capital of Kansas.
Mm.
Yeah.
Yes, Nick. I'm the funniest man alive. Sorry. Go ahead.
In speech class, I'm doing we have to do an informational speech, and I'm doing a biography on you.
All right.
Oh, my God.
Yeah, and...
it's like Abraham Lincoln's past. The simple life of the poor.
Well, I know...
Andrew, relax over there.
I know you were born in North Hollywood, but mm-hmm. I need some more information. Could you give me any?
Oh, my God. I could. I've heard it a billion times.
Well, I was born in North Hollywood. I went to North Hollywood High. What else? You asked me the questions.
Mm. His mom abandoned him. He's never gotten over it.
No, she did not.
His parents split up when he was 8. His stepmom kicked him out and made him live in the garage and crap into a popcorn tin.
Well, she didn't actually force me to, but that was my idea.
His dad didn't go to a couple Pop Warner football games, right?
Yes.
He's never forgiven him for that.
Still in therapy.
His dad, Adam is the anti-senior Carolla. His dad doesn't like mechanical things.
What high school did you attend?
North Hollywood High.
Okay.
It's very easy. Hey, Nick?
Yeah?
This is all fine and well, but you should look this stuff up on the internet.
I will a little bit, but I need a couple of sources, so I'll just use this as one.
There you go. Okay.
Yep. All right, Nick. Good times.
You know, footnote number 2. Okay, you know.
Yeah.
Adam Carolla.
Wow. The subject of his speech in speech class?
Yeah. It sounds like it's going to be an elaborate speech.
You know you've arrived. Ashley?
Yes?
You're 17.
Yeah. I made up my call.
Mm.
But, okay, here's my real question. I go to school with, like, 85% Hispanics and black, you know?
Mm-hmm.
And I've been having trouble, like, finding a decent boyfriend.
Sure.
Like... there are no normal white dudes in my mm-hmm. school.
Why don't you date somebody not white?
I I already tried that, you know, and my mom, like, she wasn't against it, but I could tell, like, in her voice, she wasn't happy about it.
Yeah, but she may not be happy about you dating anyone.
No, I mean, I've had boyfriends before.
All right, and she's been all right with that.
Yeah, like, I went out with one guy for about, you know, 8 months, you know.
Yeah.
And, I don't know, it's just, like, really tough, and it's making me stressed out, you know? Like,
all right.
I can deal without having a boyfriend, but...
Well, listen, you have no problem with dating someone of a different race, right?
I mean...
It's your mom's issue.
Well, you'd prefer a white guy.
Yeah.
But any port in a storm, right? I mean, you don't have much choice. There's not too many white guys in that school, right?
No. I mean, there are, but, you know, either they all smoke pot or, you know, they have girlfriends.
All right. Sounds like a fantastic school you're going to.
Yeah, it's lovely.
And do you have to date someone from school? I mean, do you do anything else? Are you involved
outside
with any other organizations?
Horseback riding?
Well, yeah, actually, I do horseback riding.
How did I know that?
Really?
I picked that up. I just... Washington, D.C. You're probably Chevy Chase, Maryland.
No.
Well, hold
Virginia
on. She's
Maryland.
Going to school. It's all black and Hispanic. What do you think? She's one of the Rothschilds?
Yeah, but the way she's talking about it all, she's...
I live near Beltsville.
Arlington.
Yeah.
Okay. Listen, Ashley.
Uh-huh.
If you really find a black or Hispanic or any other nationality guy that really flips your cookie, go ahead and date him. Okay.
Yeah, but I don't think they're going to flip my cookie.
Okay, then if you don't, then you're going to have to find a guy outside of your school, like at your horseback riding camp or wherever you go.
All right? Yeah.
And stay open. You may find a guy.
Okay, hey, Adam.
Yeah.
What does mahalo mean?
Mahalo means everything in Hawaiian.
Okay. Everything that aloha doesn't mean,
right.
Mahalo fills out.
They have two words, those Hawaiians. They have aloha and they have mahalo. I really do. I think if you're in Hawaii and you're a surgeon and you're removing the heart, I think you either have to call it aloha or mahalo. Is that true, Drew?
That's it.
They're really the laziest people on earth. They really are. They have two words that mean 4,000 things. Joanna?
Yeah, hi.
You're 16. What's going on?
Yeah, I'm a couple of weeks late on my period, and I haven't taken a pregnancy test yet, but I think I might be pregnant, and I want to know if there is any way that I could ensure that I had a miscarriage.
Ensure that you have one?
Yeah.
Well, you can take RU486, the abortion pill.
Well, it's like the after... Isn't that like the... You have to do it like the morning after?
No, that's the morning after pill.
Okay.
So RU46 can be taken up to the first, basically, 3 months.
Okay.
But you have to see a doctor, and it's an abortion, and you need to get that taken care of. That's what you're going to do.
Okay, so what should I do? Should I, like, go to a doctor?
Or? Yeah, go to your doctor. Planned Parenthood.
Okay.
I'm sure there's a very good Planned Parenthood in Denver. That's where you are.
Mm-hmm. One of my favorite Planned Parenthoods is in Denver.
Yeah.
Beautiful.
Yeah.
Yeah, that fishbowl filled with condoms at the front desk, second to none. And the ambiance there, fantastic. And
yeah,
that John Denver music playing, it's great.
But get the proper counseling and make a decision with someone who can help you make a decision about what you want to do with this pregnancy.
Yeah.
Can you go and get RU486 from Planned Parenthood now?
I don't know that.
Are they sporting that?
I don't know. And it's probably different in different Planned Parenthoods.
See, I don't know. I don't even know if I'm pregnant, but I know is there any other reason why I would be late like this?
The number one, two, and three possibilities of pregnancy. There are many other possibilities, but you need to rule out pregnancy first and foremost.
Yeah.
And I'd rather you do it with Planned Parenthood so they can also establish some contraception for you, since obviously you're not practicing that.
Yeah, well, I don't know if I'm pregnant or not because it was protected. The last four guys that I've slept with have been protected.
The last four?
Yeah, so that's what I'm thinking. Like, maybe in the last month, I've slept with maybe four guys.
Oof.
But they're
using condoms?
Yeah.
Condoms fail.
Yeah, but I always check. That's one thing I do. I always check to make sure it's broken or not, and none of them have been broken. And
okay, well...
I used to take Depo. I used to be on Depo.
Once you get back on Depo, that'd be a good contraception
for
you.
Hey, Joanna?
I'm bugging my parents to take me, and they won't.
Go to Planned Parenthood.
Joanna.
Yeah.
What's up? I mean, you're very comfortable with your sexuality at 16.
Uh-huh.
I always check the condoms. I have slept with...
Four
guys in the last month.
Yeah, that sounds pretty bad, but it's kind of complicated.
All right. But slow down a little. Take care of yourself, right?
All right.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Don't worry about guys making you feel one way or the other.
Okay.
You got to make yourself feel that way.
All right.
All right.
All right, thanks.
All right, good times.
Okay.
Always checks the condom.
Nice.
Like a nurse. Melissa?
Yeah.
You're 18?
No, actually, I'm 28.
Oh, well, must have been a little typo there.
I'm 28, but I didn't make up my question.
All right, go.
God.
I have been seeing my boyfriend for, oh, gosh, it's going on 5.5 years now.
Oh.
Yeah, and it's getting to that point where I'm getting a little bit frustrated, and I want more of a commitment out of the relationship.
You want to get married?
Yeah.
How old is he?
He's 37.
Oh, my God. Oh, my God. He was dating you when he was 32 and you were 13?
No, actually, I was 24.
No, no.
Oh, I'm sorry. It's not 18. I beg your pardon.
Screwing the math up
there. We have 18 up on the board here, so.
Yeah.
Okay.
And I'm feeling really frustrated. I live with him, which is probably my biggest mistake.
How long have you been with him, living with him?
2 years.
Oof. I think one rule women should have is that when you move in with the guy...
Uh-huh.
1 year. Stop clock. Right. Just give them 1 year to make up their mind. But if you decide to move in, fine. But 1 year and that's it.
You know, the biggest thing, the biggest problem I have is I hate to give him the ultimatum.
Why?
Because I feel like our relationship is so good. We don't argue.
Hey, it's not good. You need to move it along. You want to get married. You want to have a family. You need something else out of this relationship. And he's old enough. He's a big boy. It's time for him to make a decision. It's not like you guys are 17.
Exactly.
He's 32. You're 28. It's time to make a decision.
Wait a minute. I think he's 37.
He's 37, for crying out loud. Right.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, he was 32 when this all started.
Hey, Melissa.
Yeah?
Do you want to have kids?
Not right now, no.
Melissa, why are you so afraid to assert what you want? I would like, you're talking like parables, like, I'd like to get something more out of this relationship, maybe some more commitment. We ask you about kids, well, you want to get married, you want to have kids, come on.
I do, and then
I think you're afraid to say that you do, because you realize this guy doesn't necessarily want the same thing as you do.
Yeah,
true. I think you want to have her kids.
No, I've heard this too many times from women not to know what they're talking about when they start down this path.
Well, can't you be married and not have kids?
Absolutely, but I suspect that you want that more than you are at least letting on tonight. I suspect, and if you're not, great, that's wonderful. But I get the vibe, as I've gotten many women I've talked to, that I mean, why in such a hurry to get married?
I'm sorry.
Why is it so important to get married?
Well, I feel there's something missing.
What will happen? What will be different if you get married?
Probably nothing, but...
So why is that important?
Because it's, it makes, there's a commitment there.
But why, why do you need a commitment? He's been with you for 5 years. He's a very committed guy. He's been able to carry on in a committed relationship, monogamous.
I don't feel like it's a commitment. I mean, marriage is a commitment to me. Everything else before that is just leading up to it. Marriage is the commitment, not the relationship. I mean, yeah, we're committed, but marriage is the ultimate commitment.
Yeah.
This gives you more security.
I understand that, but, you know, seeing how, you know, 50% of them are over in the first 5 years, how big a commitment? I mean, you're looking at it like it's carved in stone and God has ordained it. He can go ahead and get divorced in 3 years.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I understand what you're asking, but it's not the end all and be all.
You see where I'm going with this, yes?
Yes.
Yeah.
Here's what I'm hearing from Melissa as well. She wants a few things out of this guy. She's sort of scared to step up and ask for them, so she's sort of subjugating her needs.
Yes.
She's saying, well, it may be kids one day. Well, it'd be nice for marriage. Not that anything's going to change.
Yeah.
We'll just get married and everything will stay the same.
Nonsense.
No, Melissa, you have to step up and ask for what you want, and you have to be prepared for the answer to be no.
How do I do that without sounding like I'm giving him an ultimatum?
What's wrong with an ultimatum?
You can't. That's it. That's what it is.
Why is an ultimatum so scary for you?
Because she doesn't want to freak him out.
Yeah, I don't feel it's fair.
Well, why is it fair? Why is it fair to have it go along the way it is now? You've been very patient.
Right.
It's time. Give him a year. Give him 6 months. Give him whatever. Put a compromise down in terms of a duration after which you can't go on. There's nothing wrong with that. You have something you want from life that he should be able to offer you, and if not, but I'm telling you that is the I hear her biological clock, and that's about kids.
Yeah,
that is about kids. And if she doesn't sort of admit that she's not being honest with herself.
Zipporah?
Yeah.
Zip is your name? Is Zipporah?
Zipporah.
Zipporah?
Yeah.
What's happening, Zipporah?
First of all, I'd like to compliment y'all. Y'all doing a good job.
Thank you.
And second of all, my real problem is that I'm 23 years old right now. I had a boyfriend when I was 18 years old, and he tried having sex with me when I was 20 years old, but it was very painful, and I was like, you know what, I gotta quit here, and I had to even stop seeing him because I didn't want to take him through that pain. Like, anytime we have sex, then I start crying because it's very painful, and I tell him that we have to stop. And that was the one and last time that I ever had tried to have sex in my life. And mm-hmm. I have this other guy who wants to marry me.
So this guy's gone. This first guy.
The first one is gone, yeah.
How old were you when that happened?
I was 18 years old.
Okay.
Yeah.
And it was, I was 20 years old when it did happen, but I was 18 years old when I first started seeing him.
Right, okay. And now, you're virgin then?
Yeah. So it's like, now I have this other guy, and he's a very good guy. He loves me so much. He want to marry me, and I've been with him for 2 years. And I've explained to him about this problem, and I just don't want to hurt him, and I wanted to know if it was...
Well, have you seen a doctor about this?
Yeah. They took me into the emergency room because anytime I have my menstrual period, I have extreme pains. And one time I was throwing up blood, but they took me into the emergency room and they were about to do something on me. And I was screaming because I can't stand pain. And I'm a vegetarian, so it's like I try my best to watch what I eat and everything because I don't like pain and I don't like going to the hospital. And when they took
what does being a vegetarian have to do with not liking pain and liking going to the hospital?
No, because they said that if you don't like the hospital, then you have to watch what you put in your system. And that's why I always do that.
All right. Well, hold on a second now. Throwing up blood. You ever throw up blood, Drew?
No.
Well, it wasn't a lot. It was just...
There's something called a Mallory Weiss tear. If you vomit a bunch of times, you'll retch, you'll tear your esophagus. Yeah. And
I thought I was throwing up blood once and turned out just to be Hawaiian Punch and Everclear. So, totally different thing.
This is
all right, well, listen. You have a new guy. You're a virgin. Were you ever traumatized growing up? Is there some reason why your vagina is not operating correctly?
Actually, no.
Nothing emotional?
I've never been raped. I've never been abused. And, I mean, when I was a kid, I was getting all the injections and everything I was supposed to do.
Injections for what?
No, she just means for the child inoculations and things like that.
Yeah, I'm just saying something like
that. She doesn't have polio.
Really, it ain't nothing. I've never been. And that's the main thing that scares me because it really ain't nothing. And I just want to know if that was natural because I'm telling you.
No,
How about a tampon? Can you put a tampon in?
No.
Because it hurts.
That's that stuff that when a lady is on her menstrual period, they put in there?
A little sponge, like little.
I heard about that.
Who is this, Jodie Foster from that movie? What was that movie called? Come on, Nell,
yeah.
You're a 23-year-old woman. I got to explain what a tampon is to you?
Feral child.
I know what it is, but
Chicopee.
I'm just saying. I heard that it's very dangerous. People start getting...
toxic shock syndrome?
Yeah, after they take it, and I never took... And see, I get...
Hey, Zipporah, listen, about 100 million women...
Zipporah fought Rodan in the classic Zipporah versus Godzilla.
About 100 million women use tampons, and toxic shock syndrome is very rare. All you gotta do is change it regularly, and you will not get toxic shock.
Zipporah?
Yeah.
But there's something going on, Zipporah. You need to like sit down with a nurse or a doctor and really go over how your body works and why you have pain and have a pelvic exam and really have somebody explain things to you a little bit. There may be a hymen there that you're having trouble breaking. There may have been some trauma that you weren't aware of. Maybe you have some pelvic problems. Maybe you have vaginismus, which is a contraction of the muscles of the floor of the pelvis that can cause a lot of discomfort. But you're going to need somebody to talk this through with you and explain it. Yeah, some I have nurse practitioner friends will actually pull a mirror out and help women. Really, they really talk them through.
Oh, yes. Have them squat on it.
Oh, well, no, they just show them as they're up in the stirrups. Everything.
Oh, yeah?
Oh, yeah.
I don't know if that's a great plan.
Adam, for crying out loud,
would you want to look at your asshole if you were
spread
over something?
You get a carbuncle at your ass, and you're doing surgery on
it. I did
mirrors.
It myself.
That's the point. Somebody can help. Could have helped you with that.
Nurse
mirror position.
Practitioner with her compact out and a mini mag light trying to show me my hooch. How dare you? Okay, see somebody, please. If you love this guy, see somebody.
Yeah, yeah.
Right, we'll take a break. When we come back, speak to Kenny. Kenny said, girlfriend has a really bad odor coming out of guess which area, folks, after this. Yep, that's my favorite new riff. This band, lean in and tell me who it is, Anderson. Thank you for the fifth time. Newfound Glory will be in here the 20th, right? Am I right about that? 22nd. All right. Well, that was close. Anyway, I'll shower praise on them, and we'll listen to that song over and over again. That's Dr. Drew. I'm Adam Carolla. Phone number 1-800-LOVE-191. And as promised, we're going to speak to Kenny. His girlfriend has a little odor downstairs, right, Kenny?
Yeah, what's up, guys? How you doing?
Good.
Yeah, you know, I have a little problem, my girl, you know. I love this girl to death, you know what I'm saying? But, like, every time we have sex, it seems to be, like, some odor coming out, and I'm too, like, embarrassed to tell her. And it's really, like, turning me off, you know. My thing go down every time I smell it. Just
yeah.
Turns me off completely. I don't know what to do. Can you guys help me out?
I smell bogus on this call.
There's no bogus, man.
I was strangely having this conversation with somebody today.
Really?
Yeah, a friend of mine, African-American.
Really?
Very sensitive to this issue.
True. I thought you said you'll never hang out with another black man again.
No.
No?
He said this is an issue that, you know, I said, well, get your tanks out and, you know, get your scuba tanks out and there you go. His girlfriend, somebody he liked.
Well, let me ask you.
Deal breaker.
Right. Okay, Kenny?
Yeah.
What color are you?
Me? I'm half black, half Dominican.
Wow.
Yeah.
Now, does the black side of you not want to go down on her?
Yeah, I guess
because,
so.
Because there's a...
Yeah, it's been affecting me, you know. Before I used to go, now it's like, I don't even want to go there no more, yeah.
But there's a rumor or a wives' tale or adage or maybe a cultural truth.
A consensus.
And I've said this for many years that I learned it when I was playing football. I had a black guy tell me once, you don't eat nothing that gets up and walks away when he's done. And I talked to some of the other brothers on the team, and I realized these weren't big fans of oral sex, the black man. Are you not a big fan of oral sex, or is it her smell?
Of course. I mean, like, my Dominican side will come out of it, you know what I mean? And he'll go down there.
So you,
Sammy Sosa in it, and then I go down.
So you're saying that the black side of you doesn't want to go down there, but the Dominican side is so sex-crazed that it'll go down there.
No, but I mean, you know...
But that, like, olfactory nerve.
I mean, like, see, if I go down there, it don't smell. But once I penetrate, right?
Oh, once you get the juices flowing.
Right. Then for some, you know, for some reason that odor comes out.
Interesting, right? Interesting.
And I'm so embarrassed, you know, like, to bring it up.
Right, right. Well, okay, but Drew, what about that? Because we haven't had this where the guy's penis acts like a swizzle stick that stirs the drink that brings out the flavor.
Do you know
what I mean?
Yeah, but I think that's because some women are sort of tight that way, and that happens. And also, I suspect he's not spending a lot of time with his mouth there.
Might she have an infection?
She might. So why don't you give him a little advice about hearing about this on Loveline?
Okay. All right. Kenny?
Yeah.
Oh, sorry, Belch. Here's what you have to do.
All right.
Wait a minute. There it goes. Sorry. You have to tell her that you're concerned about her, that you were listening to this show, and that someone else called in and said their girlfriend had a little scent downstairs, and Drew seemed concerned, and that Drew said it may be an infection, and she could be sterile and have all kinds of other problems. So, because you love her so much, you'd love her to get checked out.
And any bad smell like that is infection until proven otherwise. And infection is very simple, and then we'll take the smell away.
It's a symptom, right, Drew?
It's a symptom, exactly.
So bring it up like it's a symptom, and you're the caring boyfriend instead of the pig that you are.
You also say it's normally, you know, it's normally lilacs and roses, but there was a sudden change, and that's what scared you.
Right. Now it's fish heads and bad milk. And buttermilk that's been out in the sun. Matt?
Yeah?
You're 13?
Yeah.
What's up?
Today I came to school a little bit late, and my friend came up to me and told me that a friend's cousin got cut up, right? And this is gang-related just because he was wearing a blue shirt, right? And this gang, they're Mexican, and they're called the Blue Monkeys.
Mm-hmm.
Which is kind of stupid, but
yeah.
Anyways.
It could be the Brown Monkeys, right?
The what?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
Okay, anyways. And then on the way home, there was supposed to be a fight, and it was going to be at my school, but they had it heavily secured, and one person went to juvie and one ran away.
Because of the fight?
Yeah.
Okay.
And then, well, a fight went on earlier in the morning, but then there was supposed to be one after school. And so, you know, I was going to go to it, and it wasn't going to be at my school. It was going to be up at a high school. And on my way there...
Well, why are you going to the fight?
Because I want to kick that person's butt that did it to my friend's cousin.
That cut up your friend's cousin.
Which I did. I broke that person's nose and made them pay for what they did.
Right, yeah, good times.
So why are you going to a more fight?
Oh, well, I'm not going to, but I heard that tomorrow now. I'm not any part of this anymore. No one knows that no one really knows that I broke that kid's nose. And so now tomorrow, there's a 75% to 80% chance that there's going to be shootings at my school tomorrow. And I was talking to my brother's friend on the commuter, and they said that I should like write an anonymous note or something.
Yeah,
you got to school or something.
Yeah, you got to notify these people, right?
Well, how do you know there's going to be a 75% to 80% chance?
Because they're going to get a whole bunch of other cousins, and the. From growing up in a bad neighborhood, I know what the chances are of there being a shooting.
Do you think this is
at school?
Oh no, this is going to be during school.
This is going to be a copycat of the Santee experience, you think, or
this is going to be like not like a copycat of like Columbine almost, but like what happened down in San Diego earlier.
You think it's going to be like that?
It's going to be like that, yeah.
Well, I think you have an obligation to alert some people to this.
I still don't understand why it's going to be like that. This is a gang-related thing?
Yeah.
And so one gang's going to shoot up another gang at school, or are they just going to shoot people randomly?
Gang against gang, and probably a little bit of randomly.
Why the random part?
Well, you know how it is when you're in a gang. You got to take a certain amount of innocent people with you.
Yeah, exactly.
All right.
And they were telling me to write like an anonymous note to the school, and I'm not really sure what happened.
Well, how do you do that?
Who do you give the note to?
I would probably go up to the office and just like talk to one of the principals and like hand them the note.
Well, it's not anonymous anymore, then, is it?
Well, not to the people that are gonna be shooting. It would be anonymous to the people that are gonna be shooting, but not to the office. But then I don't know
Matt?
Yeah.
Maybe he should, call the cops tonight. I mean, I'm almost sure nothing's going to happen.
But why don't you make
it
anonymous?
But on the other hand...
What about an anonymous tip to the police tonight? I mean, by tomorrow, it might be too late.
Yeah. That's what I'm kind of afraid of.
What school is it?
O'Hara Park Middle.
O'Hara Park Middle School?
Yeah.
What are you guys going up to these days? Eighth grade?
Yeah, I'm going into eighth grade pretty soon.
And when you're done with that, you're done with that school, right?
Yeah.
Jesus Christ. You got gang shootings going on over there?
Oh, yeah, there's always gang fights just about every day of the week.
Yeah, I still, like I said, I want to take this seriously, but I still don't understand why... There's going to be a big random shooting at the school because
you broke
there was a
nose.
Gang fight at a high school the day before.
It's probably not going to be random, really, but I'm just, you know, I don't really want it to happen because...
All right, well, listen, call the cops.
All right.
Call the cops and tell them what you think.
People will react very strongly to this now after all this stuff in the press.
Yes.
And for that matter, if anyone else, we had a couple calls about the Santee experience. We had some kids that were... present during that and had experienced that horror, but we'd be more than happy to keep talking about that. If people were involved with that or have feelings about it or have concerns about their own schools, that's certainly something we could talk about tonight, so feel free to call in.
Right. And I would have talked more to Matt, but it quite frankly didn't sound like...
It didn't make sense.
He wasn't really putting together a good story,
right.
Other than he knows something or has a feeling.
But he has an obligation.
It's his obligation to call the police tonight. All right, and no better time to do that, by the way, historically, than tonight.
And Ann's going to keep talking to him.
Desiree?
Yeah.
You're 18?
I'm almost 18, yeah.
What's up?
Well, last Friday, I was having problems all week last week with my parents.
Hey, Desiree, hang on one second. Ann?
Okay.
Get the name of that school again. Okay. Go ahead. I'm sorry.
I was having problems with my family all last week, and I moved in with my friend, and then I went to the hospital Friday because I was sick, and my boyfriend went with me. And we went back to his hotel room, and my friend and me and him were all there, and we were partying, having a good time and all, and I'm a recovering alcoholic addict.
Well, sure. I mean, you're 17.
So, what do you mean you were partying?
I'm recovering. Well, they were drinking, and we were smoking bud.
That's not recovery.
I know.
That's active use. That's your in your right. disease.
Right.
Okay, so you're not recovering.
No, I was recovering until that point.
Okay, all right.
And, well, me and my boyfriend started having, we were all going to have a threesome together, right?
Right.
But then we changed our minds.
Sure.
Okay. Yeah. And then me
very
and him
disappointing
started,
for your boyfriend.
Oh,
though.
That train left the station. What?
That is a buzzkill right there. Hey, we're going to have a threesome.
I don't believe he stopped.
No, he ain't.
But, and then me and we just decided for her to watch. Okay, she started watching, and I felt really uncomfortable. And then after a while, we quit, and then next thing I knew, I was laying down going to sleep, and he had sex with her.
See, I knew it was coming to this.
You're a Nostradamus over there. Hey, Desiree?
Yeah.
A few questions.
Uh-huh.
What was he in the hospital for?
I was in the hospital.
What were you in the hospital for?
I was really sick that day.
Oh, well, then that's fine. And what were you in the hospital for?
It was just a virus I caught.
Why'd you go to the hospital?
I was dehydrated. I couldn't keep nothing down.
Vomiting a lot.
Okay. So you were partying and screwing that night?
Yeah.
Wow. Oh, to be 17 again, huh, Drew? You're dehydrated and hooked up to an IV. You know, basically 1 foot in the grave at 3 in the afternoon. And that night, you're doing bong loads and getting laid.
Threesome.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And why was your boyfriend staying at a hotel?
Because he's from out of state. He's from North Carolina.
I see.
He just broke up with a girlfriend. I haven't even known him 3 weeks
yet. Okay. What'd you meet him, on the internet?
No.
How old is he?
He's 20.
At a military base or something?
He came down to Missouri. He had another girlfriend, and they broke it off.
All right. Okay.
And then he came down, and he was drinking a lot, because my stepdad and my mom used to work for the taxi cab company, and I still have friends that work for the taxi cab, and they were hauling him around, and they brought him by where I worked.
Hauling him around drunk.
Okay, listen. Nice. Desiree.
Mm-hmm.
I don't mean to cut you off, but I mean to cut you off.
Okay.
You're recovering.
Not recovering.
But you're not really recovering.
Right.
This guy's pretty much an alcoholic. I don't even know what's up going on with your friend. You're somehow dehydrated at 17 going to the hospital. Let's take another look at life here, baby. And the road you're going down.
Mm-hmm.
Because this road is paved with kids and bills and trailers and rope holding your pants up and having to climb the telephone pole to use the phone, like Green Acres.
Mm-hmm.
It's not going to be a good life for you.
Right.
If you survive.
Let's not go down that road.
Right.
You don't have any kids, do you?
No.
Oh.
Okay.
I don't plan on having kids.
Do not get pregnant.
I don't plan on it.
This guy is very suspect.
Oh,
I don't
yeah.
trust him.
Well,
and
that?
You got to get sober again.
You got to call your sponsor. You got to start going to meetings right away.
I broke it off with him yesterday because he tried to get me to take him to where he gets his drugs, and I told him.
Good, not good. Just, dump him and get back with your sponsor.
Yep.
Start dating your sponsor, right, Drew?
No.
Yes, do what Drew says. Date your sponsor.
No.
And we'll be back. Yeah. Loveline. I'm Adam Carolla. He's Dr. Drew over there. Solving your problems Sunday through Thursday night. Every night. 10 to midnight. Loveline. Phone number 1-800-LOVE-191. And it's back to the phones. We're going.
Nolan.
Yes.
What's up?
I'm not really sure.
Well, you called, right?
Huh?
You're 27.
Yes.
There's the start. What's the question?
The question is, why would my wife urinate during... This has happened two times. Once during oral and once during regular intercourse.
Is it when she has her orgasm?
I'm not really sure. She has a few orgasms during sex.
So she's sort of multiply orgasmic.
Yeah.
Yeah, some women lose their urine when they have an orgasm. Not every time, but sometime. And are you sure it's urine and not just female ejaculate?
It's definitely urine.
Okay, well, that's what happens sometimes. It's called female orgasmic incontinence. Not uncommon.
In the mouth during the oral sex, huh?
Well, no, it's kind of like in my eyebrows and...
I see.
Yeah, nice.
Bad times. And, but you got right back down there the next night, huh?
No.
Wow.
Not the next night.
I see.
No, this, it happened, it's... Like, the first time it happened, it was oral, and that's been, like, 4 or 5 months ago.
All right, well.
Last night, it was during regular intercourse, and I freaked out because I thought I might have hurt her.
Right, sprung a leak.
Yeah.
Punctured her bladder or something,
You
huh?
smoke a lot of weed, Nolan?
Me?
No.
I used to when I was in high school, about a bag a week.
Yeah.
What are you doing now?
You
drinking a lot?
Just working.
Drinking a lot.
Are you drinking?
Right now?
In general.
No, not very often.
All right.
I do sometimes.
All right, do you still go down on your wife?
Not as often as I used to.
No.
Maybe ask her to evacuate her bladder before all that action gets going, okay?
No, we do. We make sure that does.
Forget about her. I'd squeeze her like a bar rag. I'd give her like a Heimlich-type maneuver over the tub before we got into bed again.
All right.
Oh, bye. No, this guy might just do that.
I just wasn't sure if it was a medical problem or...
No, it's a fairly...
Beating it up too hard.
It's not an uncommon experience. You're doing fine.
Okay.
All right.
Thank you.
All right, good times there. Yeah. Something was up with him.
Yeah. He sounded like one of those characters from a Bugs Bunny movie, like the Gulcher, the Vulture. No.
No, can't do it. No. The Bashful Vulture.
Yes, the Bashful Vulture.
Yeah, the big over-domineering mom. Italian mom. You'll go out there and you'll fry. You'll fly with the... No. Gary?
Yeah.
You're 18?
Yes.
What's up?
My girlfriend's mom... has been talking to me, asking me if I wanted to have sex with her for about 3 weeks now.
How old is she?
She's 40 years old.
And why? How long you known your girlfriend?
Me and her's been dating for about 4 months now.
4 months. And the mother's been at you for 3 weeks, did you say?
Yeah.
And what do you mean she's been talking to you about having sex?
Well, she said she's been telling me that she's been attracted to me. Ever since me and Sharon's been going out. And my girlfriend don't know about it, and I don't know what to do. And I'm also attracted to her. So, what should I do?
The more you talk, the less I believe you.
Yeah. Smells bogus to me, Gary.
Yeah.
It's not.
Gotta be honest with you.
You know, usually when people are in this kind of situation, they don't divulge the name of the person that's involved in this.
Yeah, but Gary,
well,
be the sharpest pencil.
Yeah, that's
the
what I'll give him that.
Gary?
Yeah.
You want to have sex with her too? Does she drink?
No.
It really seems like the kind of thing someone would do when they were drunk.
Do you love your girlfriend?
Yes, I do.
Why would you do this to her?
Well, I don't really want to do it to her.
Okay, well, that's that then, huh? Then don't.
All right.
And don't put yourself in situations where you might be tempted. This is the thing that bothers me about guys. Like, I really don't want to do this. But, you know, they go marching down that path. They still sit down and have a couple glasses of wine with the mom. Just to sort of...
Right. Carrie, what's going on back there?
Nothing.
All right. See ya. I didn't buy it.
No, that was bogus.
And 90% of the bogus calls are the
mom
wants girlfriend's mom wants to bed me.
But don't go down the path.
Ethan?
Yeah?
You're 16.
Oh, hi.
Hey.
What's up?
Yeah, I go to Santana, and, like, I'm, like, a sophomore there. And, like, I was, like, in the small quad when, like, the shooting happened. And, like, I didn't really see anything except for, like, the guy on the ground. Like, there was this guy on the ground. And then, like, the people, like, came around him, and they were, like, 5 feet away from him. And they all came, like, up to him. And then, like, I thought it was, like, a joke or something. And then, like, I turned around, and I grabbed my backpack. And then when I looked back, everyone, like, scattered. And then, like, he got up and, like, he ran off. And, like, he had blood coming out of his mouth because he got shot in, like, the lip or something.
Huh.
Uh-huh. And then I saw, like, the narc come out of the bathroom or like, around the corner. And he, like, came out and, like, he just, like, stumbled onto the ground. Okay? And then, like...
You said the narc?
The narc, yeah. He's,
the
like,
police?
The campus supervisor. Huh. They, like, watched.
Right. Hold on a second.
Hang on a second. Hey, we're going to talk to you some more. This is about the Santee shooting.
Okay.
Right. Boy, remember narcs, Drew?
Yeah.
Oh, you went to the Little Lord Fauntleroy School for albino hemophiliacs.
There were narcs there, too.
Yes, but it was Sir Narc, and he wore an ascot. Right?
Yeah.
All right. We'll take a break, and then we'll get back more into this San Diego tragedy with Ethan after this. Loveline. I'm Adam. That's Drew. Phone number 1-800-LOVE-191. When we left off, we were speaking to Ethan. Ethan is 16. He's calling about the Santee tragedy in San Diego. Two people died, 13 wounded or injured.
13, 14. It goes back and forth.
And injured doesn't necessarily mean wounded. Could have been someone diving out of the way and
sure.
whacking their head on a bench or something.
Right.
It wasn't necessarily shot.
Right.
And I don't know what the answer to that is. How many people were actually shot?
Right. It was more than a few.
All right. And Ethan says he attends that high school and that he was there during the shooting. Right, Ethan?
Right.
And you say somebody got shot in the lip.
Yeah, because like my teacher told me that he was walking into the bathroom and then the gunman came out of the bathroom and pointed at his head. And when he reacted, he like turned his head and I guess the bullet went right through his lip. It didn't like go... It didn't hit his teeth or anything. It just went, like, through his bottom lip.
Wow. How lucky.
Then he, like,
yeah,
he, like
sure
fell on
lucky,
the ground.
Bro.
He what?
He like, fell on the ground in shock, and everyone started crowding around him, and then they scattered, and then when they scattered, he got up and ran off, and that's when I saw, like, his mouth all bleeding.
Right. And where were you at the time?
I was, like, across the quad, like maybe 100 yards away.
Hey, I had a quad in high school, too. Do quads exist anywhere but high school?
Well, colleges.
Oh, they have quads?
Oh, yeah.
I see. And so, what'd you do then?
Well, I kept looking, and then, like, I saw the narc. When the narc came out, some gunshots happened, and then that's when I split. Like, I ran to the office.
Does the narc pack a gun?
No. They're like, college students, usually, that just get hired to do this as part-time thing.
Huh.
Yeah, and they're, like, just there to, like, stop fights and bust kids smoking pot.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
All right, so, but you all know who they are?
Yeah.
Okay. And did you get some therapy, or did you talk to anybody, a counselor, or anything like that?
Well, no, because I kind of feel stupid talking to them.
Why?
Well, because, like, I don't trust them as counselors because, like, I'll like, say something and they'll probably just go tell the office and be like, he's going to shoot up Colin. He's going to shoot up the school again.
Is that and, something like, you were planning on?
No.
Why would they accuse you of that if that's not something you're suggesting you're going to do?
Well, like, because, like, I was kind of glad that narc got shot because he was, like, an a-hole and, like, I was just like, cool, he got shot and I was kind of hoping he was dead in a way.
You are an asshole.
Jesus Christ.
Yeah.
Huh.
And so like I'm kind of like freaked out about that.
Freaked out that you felt that way?
Yeah, that I was like happy.
Well, okay.
About it.
Wait a minute. Would you really wish the guy was dead?
Well, kind of like I guess if I really sat down and thought about it, I probably wouldn't, but
well, did the guy ever do anything to you personally?
Well, yeah, he's always been an asshole to me. He's like, oh, sorry about that. Hello?
Yeah, we're here.
Okay, yeah, but like, he's like bugs. He like comes up to me and like tells me to move when like it's not even necessary. It's just like stupid crap like that.
Huh.
And just really kind of pisses me off.
Mm. Okay.
Yeah, Ethan, you sound like a little handful yourself.
Oh, really?
Yeah, you sound pretty angry. Are you angry?
My teachers say I'm depressed.
Yeah, you could be depressed and angry and irritable.
You don't think about shooting anyone, do you?
No, well, like, I thought about it until, like, the shooting is, and now I think it's, like, really selfish. Because it's like you like hurt all those people, and like I see how what they go through, all the pain that they go through, and it's just really selfish, I guess.
What makes you want to shoot someone? What how does that go?
I don't know. It just kind of like a fantasy in my head, I guess. Not really something I'd act out, but just something in my head.
So something that would be gratifying to you in some way.
In some way, in my head, I guess.
Yeah, but you have no plan.
The consequences would be too great for me to actually do it.
And the consequences are that you can understand the pain it actually inflicts on other people.
Yeah, and that's one of the reasons why I wouldn't do it.
How do you think the other guy was able to carry that kind of thing out?
Andy Williams. I think he just, like all that anger, like, bottled up inside of him, and, like, it just exploded out.
But how does that go from fantasy to action, do you think?
I guess he thought about it and thought about it and thought about it and thought about it, and then it just became normal.
Huh.
And then I guess it just, like, became reality, what he was thinking in his head.
So in your case, don't you think it would be a good idea to talk to somebody before you keep ruminating about this stuff?
Explode somewhere?
Yeah, to the point that you explode or this becomes normal for you?
Yeah.
Yeah, why don't you do something about that? This is not something to just sit around with. Plus, it's got to be kind of troubling to have witnessed all that, and that's got to make you more irritable and more anxious.
Well, like, I didn't really see that much.
Listen, you're calling the show. You're telling us you were close enough, you know?
Yeah.
That's enough. And listen, somebody said you were depressed.
Uh-huh.
Hey, you have to pursue that. You really do.
Yeah, I guess I'll talk to my dad about that.
Great. Talk to your dad about
Perfect.
It, please.
The fact that you can is a good
why
sign.
Why go through life that way? You don't have to do that.
All right, Ethan. Thanks for calling.
Okay.
All right. Good times. Ooh. Ethan had a little more in him than we initially thought.
That's right.
Mental note. Homeschooling for kids.
Not such a bad option. Huh?
Yeah. Huh. Yeah. A week ago, I was making fun of all those homeschool kids. Now, I think it's the only option. All right. Let's talk to Tony. Tony's 30. Tony?
Hi.
Yes.
I just ended a committed relationship of about 3 years. And before that, I was married for 7 years. And getting back into the dating pool and basically ready to, you know, do just about anything in pants.
Yeah. You know, I don't want to scare you, but Drew peed in the dating pool before he got out.
So do my kids.
A little known fact.
What I'm worried about is I'm kind of shortchanged downstairs.
What does that mean?
What I mean?
No. Small penis. What do you mean?
Well, what is
him to explain
what's
it, right?
What's the length we're talking about here?
5 on a good day.
Mm-hmm. You mean like on a hot summer day?
Yeah. So, you know, like my preferred, I've been told that I'm, you know, fairly talented orally.
Sure.
But what I'm worried about is, you know, picking up something that way, either, you know, receiving or giving.
Now, why are you worried about that as opposed to intercourse?
Well, you know, with intercourse, you can wear a condom.
I see. And you're not willing to wear a latex.
Nobody
latex
is.
Barrier.
Listen, that whole vaginal Tupperware thing they worked out.
Yeah.
What was that thing called?
The female condom?
No.
The dental dam?
The dental dam. That thing's a disaster.
You ever
that
use
never
one?
Worked. Hell no. Are you kidding me? What the hell would you do with that thing?
Just lay the saran wrap down there.
And then lick the saran wrap? I can do that at home while I jack off. Hold on, mental note. Lick saran wrap at home while I jack off.
Is there something about the tongue contacting that area that's especially appealing?
It's just the idea of putting a piece of cellophane
rubber
over the vagina like you're going to freeze it and eat it in a month. It just seems bizarre. And listen, if you got to whip that thing, if you got to get out that cellophane, maybe you should just slow down with the relationship a little if you don't know where that thing's been. Tony?
Right.
Don't overthink. Well, you know, Don't overthink it. Don't overthink this. Your penis is not so small, you think you're going to get laid the first night you go out. You're not. Just slow down and start dating.
Yeah, I'm just not really looking for, like, a relationship at this point.
All right. Well, still, just kind of slow down. Know the people you're going to be intimate with a little better.
Okay.
All right.
All right there.
Thanks.
All right, buddy. I think we broke his spirit.
Yeah, he sounded pretty disappointed.
A broken man by the time we were done with him. He's like, he went from, yeah, I'm single, I'm going to get laid, to, I guess, well, okay. True. He successfully broke another young man.
I'm proud of myself.
Samantha?
Hi, can I talk to you off the air?
Yeah, who do you want to talk to off the air?
True.
Well, no.
No.
So what's your question?
I'd really rather not talk that on the air. Is it possible that anybody I can talk to?
Yeah, Laura can talk to you. Hey, hold on.
Thank you.
All right. She ain't getting you any coffee, man. She might as well talk to somebody. You know, it's real funny. It's real funny to see Drew gesture frantically with his coffee mug to Lauren and Ann, who are not looking at him. Yet I see Drew waving hysterically. It's like Drew's been trapped on an island with no coffee and a rescue plane is flying overhead. And he's like, hey, down here, I'm over here. He's waving his mug around. These two don't look at all. I just see Drew's reflection on the studio glass while he waves his mug around. Do it again, Drew. It's entertaining for me. There we go. Oh, you're ignoring him on purpose? You're doing a masterful job. I didn't even know it. Chris?
Yes?
You're 15?
Mm-hmm.
What's up?
I'm in love with my best friend's boyfriend.
Boyfriend?
Yes.
Well, that's a twist.
Yes.
Your best friend's boy. Is your best friend a boy?
No.
A girl. So you're gay?
Very.
And, oh, very, not even bi?
No.
And your best friend, does he know you're gay? She know?
Yes, she does.
And does the boyfriend know?
Yes.
Is the boyfriend bisexual?
Yes, he is.
Have you been with him?
No, but I would really like to.
Why do you want to do that to your best friend?
My best friend knows about it, and she likes it.
She likes it.
I would love to see that.
Then why are you calling us?
Because I just wanted to know if it was a good idea to let him know how I feel and if it's a good idea to go through with that.
How old is your best friend?
My best friend is 16.
Yeah.
And she would like to see you two together?
Yes, but I don't know if that's good for our friendship or not.
No, not good for anything. Not good for you, not good for their relationship, not good for your friendship. This will break down in a lovely, chaotic mess.
And let's not forget the sofa pillows.
Yes.
Those are the ones who really suffer in these acts. The forgotten ones. The slip covers. Chris.
Yeah.
Is there a lot of chaos in your life?
Oh.
Yes, there is.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, what's going on with you?
Well, I was in the school. I was in regular high school, and then word got out that I was gay, and I couldn't take it there, so I had to go to homeschool.
Huh.
And
this blows your theory about homeschooling.
And there's just, I don't know, I hate my parents.
Right. How come?
I'm not sure.
Really? You don't have a reason for hating your parents?
No, I just, they make me sick.
Really? But no reason.
Well, there is. I just don't really want to bring that up.
Oh, something embarrassing?
No, it gets me really upset.
Painful.
Painful.
Is it like an abuse of some type?
Oh, no abuse. I don't. Not that I can remember.
Well, how is it so painful if it's not an abuse? I mean, no molestation, no physical abuse?
Mm-mm.
No divorce?
No divorce.
Well, they didn't get you a moped when you wanted it? I mean, what could it be?
What's so bad?
Well, here's this. I'm just messed up in the head, I think.
Okay.
All the people I know, I'm going to make myself sound like the biggest idiot on the air, but all the people I know have had a really tough life, I guess. And they are the most interesting people I know, and they're the only people I like to be around. And I've never had any problems in my life. My parents tried to make it the like ideal family with no problems or anything, and I just don't like that. Any family-oriented thing makes me sick.
Well, somewhere something happened to you.
Yeah, that little plan backfired.
Yeah, something happened. Either they just weren't available in a real way or something, something.
Okay, so
my
you're saying...
kind of lives in a dream.
You're mad at your parents for being too good?
Yes.
And not,
not being the crap
giving you enough strife so you could be a good artist?
Maybe.
Hey.
Yeah.
You need to look into some counseling. Is there a gay organization near you?
Oh,
like
no.
A youth...
Gay Lesbian Youth Center?
Small Hick Town.
Hmm.
And how about a well, you don't have a school counselor because you're homeschooled, right?
Well, yes.
Well, you hate your parents and you're home with them all day?
Yeah.
What do you got for biology this year, Mom? What do you have for Pete, Mom? Hey, what'd you get for English? Ma?
Oof.
Who do you play with? Mailman? Oh, my God. Okay. Drew, tell them what to do and hurry.
Chris, you need some sort of... how long have you been homeschooled for?
For about 6 weeks.
Oh. So you... Oh, boy.
Failing geometry.
Yeah. It seems to me that you need some sort of social support, the very minimum. I think Adam's suggestion that you get in touch with the Gay and Lesbian Youth Center is a good thing.
Yeah, except for there's not one in his town.
Yeah. The other thing is to develop a network of friends other than your artist friends, a diverse group of friends, people that can support you and you can talk to that you're feeling.
I think the guy needs to go in and get an evaluation. I mean, he may be clinically depressed.
Oh,
he's got things going on.
Make no mistake about it. All that is going on, for sure.
All right, so... you can do all that stuff, and you can also go in and talk to a doctor or a psychiatrist and see about possibly getting a diagnosis, because yep. You have things going on in your life, and they should be taken care of. Nick?
Yeah.
You're 20.
Yeah.
What's up?
All right. I'm having a whole bunch of problems with my back. Apparently, they found a compression fracture, which is... the disc is actually protruded into the spinal cord. And they're telling me that... doctors are telling me that I cannot have sex. I was wondering if there's any other way. What the hell you'd do?
Well, you gotta kill yourself.
That's pretty much what I'm at.
Well, how did you injure yourself?
I'm not real sure.
You're 20 now.
I'm 20.
How long have you been suffering with this?
Almost a year.
Yeah. How long you been on Vicodin?
Ain't been on Vicodin.
You ain't been on Vicodin?
No.
Percocet?
Nope. None of that stuff works.
What are you on?
I ain't gonna say.
All right, look, this is morphine addiction. This is all about opiates.
Looking.
Yeah.
Now you turn into a hillbilly.
That's why you're depressed. That's why you're contemplating suicide. This is addiction. You need to get that treated.
Well, I'm not on any pain medication at all right now.
Well, why aren't you willing to tell us what pain medicine you're taking?
I'm not taking anything right now.
Well, then why did you say you're not telling us what you're taking?
I've taken almost everything, but I'm not taking anything at the present time. I haven't taken anything in probably 3 months.
Are you drinking?
I'm not drinking. I'm not doing anything.
You're not smoking pot?
Nope.
Okay.
Well, how did it go from I'm not going to tell you what I'm taking to I'm not taking anything?
Well, I don't really want to display what I was taking because I still had some of them left.
Well, I'm sure it's morphine and Demerol and all the usual stuff, and that's where this gets going is you develop what's called a pain reward cycle.
Ooh, I got to get one of
them. And you need to have this more thoroughly evaluated. You need to see a psychiatrist. You're depressed. You've got a lot of stuff going on here. You had back pain when you were depressed, didn't you?
Yes. Thank you for bringing that up. Now my back hurts. Nick?
Yeah?
Do they want to do surgery on you?
It's real tricky because I can't find a surgeon that'll mess with it.
No, they don't do surgery. No, please, Nick. They're not doing surgery because they don't think surgery will affect the pain. Because they don't do surgery for pain. You do surgery for motor weakness, typically. But if there was something there correctable, they would correct it. The thing is, though, he has many, many people who have these sorts of injuries, and they go through life just fine. But he's been drug addicted severely, and the pain is perceiving.
He hasn't taken anything in 3 months.
he was unwilling to tell us how many different things he was strung out on. Now he's trying to white knuckle it off opiates without any treatment. People are miserable when they try to do that.
Yeah. Did Nick give you the creeps?
Oh, yeah. But he's, you know.
Something's up with Nick.
Yeah, I'm telling you.
True. Why is there something up with everyone who has back problems?
It's not everyone, but it's a lot of.
It's 95% of people that got a back problem.
It's people that are disabled by back problem or on opiates with back problems with a family history of alcoholism and who magically don't have surgery to correct it. Or if they do get surgery, the surgery starts perpetuating the pain.
You show me someone who hasn't worked in 6 months because of back problems.
And no surgery.
Who's under 50, yeah. And I'll show you someone who's strung out, freaked out, something with the word out on the end of it. Why is that? Is it back some sort of catch-all?
Back is something. People get back pain and headaches when they get depressed. People get back pain when they have addicted to opiates. The brain learns that if it has pain, it will receive the reward of opiates. So, boy, it sets up these pathways of pain that are extremely powerful.
Yeah. So I'm so bad now. I hear someone talking about their back. I'm like, nut job.
Well, whenever somebody says, I had a compression fracture and it's pressing on my spine, it gets all this weird description of what's happening. No. That's somebody in a wheelchair.
Okay. Jamie?
Yeah.
You're 19.
Yeah. My question is, me and my boyfriend, you know, sometimes, like, before, like, when we sex, I go down on him, right? And he's not circumcised.
Mm-hmm.
And I just want to, because, like, I learned in my sex class I took in college, like, what smegma is, and it's really nasty, you know?
Sure. Well, we did a whole semester on smegma when I was in junior college.
Yeah.
We did smegma analysis.
Oh, you did smegma analysis? Mm-hmm. Oh, that was a lab class, yeah. Though, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I passed on that.
Oh, you didn't anyway. Show up the lab. Okay.
Yeah. My question is, sometimes, like, when we have sex, we don't use a condom. And could the smegma, because it's, like, could that, like, give you, like, an infection or anything, like, when
yes.
you're having sex?
Well, yeast. Sometimes there's yeast in there, and that can do that to you. And then some bacteria occasionally, but not a big deal.
Yeah, because, like, I never really got a yeast infection, but then I had one, and I never had one before.
Well, but just having sex can get you yeast infection, too, though.
Yeah, well, my friend told me that, like, just the penis's period is really dirty.
No.
Well,
how dare you?
Did your mom tell you that? Because that's what I've had my wife tell my daughter.
What?
Yeah, you might as well take a stick, stuff it, you know, clean an outhouse out with it, just put it right up you. It's that bad.
My friend told me, though, that before you have sex, it's better just to, like, pop it in your mouth, and then, like, the germs are, you get rid of the saliva in your mouth.
Right. And, Jamie, where did you...
I got the same thing. Yeah. I have the same policy with my butt plug.
Jamie,
before anything goes in my ass, first I give it a good cleaning in my mouth, and then into the ass.
And Jamie, where did your friend study microbiology?
Huh?
Where did your friend study microbiology?
Smegma, you.
She didn't study microbiology.
Oh, I'm shocked. But she's an expert.
She just got them a lot and finally figured out what to do, I guess.
Oh, of course, if she figured it out, she must know exactly what she's talking about.
All right, get off that high horse, please.
The
funniest part about this call is when she seriously answered that her friend did not study microbiology. Yeah. All right.
And I have another question, too. My boyfriend, he's not too big, but he's just, like,
all right.
Perfect.
Throw him back.
He's perfect, she said. He's perfect.
Okay.
He's okay. I mean, it would be nice if it was a little bit bigger. He happens to be Mexican. Nothing against him or anything, but they happen to be small in their trunks there.
Jamie, quite a colorful gal here.
Yeah. Yeah, what's the question? You want to know how to lighten his skin?
No.
Lengthen his dork.
He kind of, like, pre-ejaculates, or, like, what, I don't know, he doesn't last very long, there you go. I used to call him a two-minute man because, yeah, but anyways,
like, hold on, I'm sorry, I gotta put her on hold for a second. Do you imagine what Jamie would do for your self-esteem if you were dating her?
Oh, yeah.
Hey, Senior Smegma! Yeah,
you know,
over here.
Two-minute man, yeah.
Yeah, two-minute man. Hey, Speedy Gun Smegma? You a happier Mexican ass over here and whip out that stinky dork of yours and let me see if I can find it with my magnifying glass. The only reason you're getting a BJ is because the thing's so smelly and dirty I'm scared to put it in me.
Gotta clean it up.
Pop, give it a quick wipe down.
Pop it in my mouth.
Then,
clean
I'm,
it up.
Then I'm gonna rinse with a little mouthwash, and I'll give you a couple minutes in, man, and then you can go back to your Telemundo. God, this Jamie sounds like a pain in the ass. Jamie.
Yes.
You are a handful. You must be.
This is. I'm telling you. Of course, I would never tell him.
All
this.
Right.
Of course,
okay.
Of course, and I did it. But as far as like getting me off, it's like never really happened, and okay. We've been having sex for like almost like a year.
Hey, Jamie.
Uh-huh.
Why don't you just break up with the poor guy?
I know.
Just break up.
But I feel so bad.
I know, but just break
up
with
the guy.
Is
there like a certain position? I mean, just besides just like using my finger, you know what I mean? Is there something else that, you know,
oral,
that could get me off easier besides?
He should do oral sex on you.
Well, he does, but
okay.
And you should guide him a little bit. Listen, let him know what's going on.
She ain't into the guy.
I know.
She's not into him. Just break up with him.
Listen,
staying with someone because you feel sorry for them is
not
a reason to stay with them.
I want to talk to that guy from Tucson, the mason jar guy.
No, you don't.
Yes, I do.
Oh, true. True. How many ideas have you ever had pertaining to entertainment?
None.
We're good.
Zero. No, I've never had any.
How many instincts have you ever had about entertainment that worked out?
None.
Okay.
Yeah.
You know what pile this one's going
in? This wasn't instinct. This was an instruction.
All right. But you got to know when to ignore.
You are my teacher.
Thank you. We'll be back. Loveline. Adam over here. Drew over there. Phone number 1-800-LOVE-191. Ready? Well, there.
Yeah.
All right. Matt.
Hey.
16.
What's going on?
Hey there, man. What's going on there, buddy?
A short-time listener, first-time caller.
Good times.
What's up?
I've been having problems at school for basically all my life. I've had a lot of kids harass me about making funny jokes like connect dots, you stinky. They say, like, stinky linky or something like that.
They make fun of you.
Yeah, basically, okay. They make fun of me.
What's the connect the dots joke?
Well, freckles.
Ah, okay.
Yeah, and it...
How are things going at home?
What's the linky part?
Yeah. Huh?
Stinky linky?
Yeah.
What's linky?
That's a name of someone that I know.
Oh, I see. That's you.
What's going on at home?
Nothing really. I mean, she's got an 8-year-old sister that doesn't really abide by our parents that much.
Doesn't what?
Doesn't,
abide by them?
Yeah.
An 8-year-old?
18-year-old.
18-year-old.
Yeah.
Hey, Matt.
Yeah.
Are you tired?
No.
Are you high or drunk or something?
No, I've only smoked once. That's it.
All right. Well, clear up your voice just a little bit, please. We're having trouble understanding you.
Okay.
There you go.
All right.
All right, Stinky Linky. people aren't kind. Kids are cruel, and you know what grown-ups are? They think the same things kids say. They just stop saying it. They're thinking Stinky Linky. And connect the dots. They just have the good sense not to say anything.
But,
do you have friends?
Not really.
That's
you
what you need.
You need friends.
You really need that.
It's kind of hard to make friends.
No, it's not.
Do you have any interests?
What do you mean? Like any hobbies?
Yeah.
The computer,
Can you connect, can you do contact other kids on the computer?
Yeah, I have friends. I like an ex-girlfriend.
You do?
Yeah, we talk lots.
Okay, all right. That's you need connection with other people. You really do. And the web, unfortunately, doesn't really serve enough, give you enough intimacy.
Speaking of Stinky Linky, something fly about now. Oh, boy. True. That's,
I do that
this
a
could
bit
be good.
Too.
You do a little farting?
Yeah.
Well, we could hang.
Oh, you did? You unleashed something.
Oh, yes.
Oh, yes.
Let a
oh,
monster
yeah.
out of
oh, yeah.
for you, Dr. Drew.
You should.
Oh.
All right, hey, Matt.
Sometimes I think of, like, I get really pissed at, like, the people and I want to hurt them, but yet I don't want to get in trouble, though.
Are you... Hey, Matt?
Yeah?
You ever been to a psychiatrist?
Yeah.
What did he say?
He said, he told me a few ways. It was a long time ago.
Did they want you to take some medication?
No.
Why don't you go back and talk to him a little more?
I haven't gone to one for four years.
Yeah, but it'd be a good idea for you to talk to someone. It sounds like you're having a lot of funny feelings right now, and we don't want to see you get in any trouble.
I'm not really a troublesome person.
All right. Well, then get some friends. You need friends. Okay? Listen, everybody, it takes a little bit of work to make friends.
Huh?
I mean, those of you who
at
are
risk.
A little antisocial, who sit around, who have a bit of a chip on your shoulder, you're not going to have any friends.
People don't like to be around that.
No, who the hell wants to be there? Go out and take a little risk. Extend your arm. See if you can find somebody who seems to be like you are, lonely, someone who needs a friend. I know it sounds corny, but I'm telling you, your friends will get you through the hardest times.
Yeah.
Drew, you don't know this because you're not allowed to hang out with males or females, but your friends are so important. My friends raised me and got me through my life. Every hard time, I had a friend there. Now I have to buy them things.
Yeah, they certainly are cashing in.
I'm the only guy who's made more than $20,000 a year out of all of them.
Well, they all live with you now, so it's all right.
But these guys were my brothers, man. I mean, I got into fights, and these guys showed up and beat guys up. I mean, these
then they take you home, beat the crap out of you.
They take
you
home, I had these guys bail me out of jail. I mean, they've done everything. Oh, it's great. Let me tell you a story off the air. I got in a fight with a guy, and Chris and Ray found out about it and showed up at the party an hour later and just went nuts. It was great. It almost brought a tear to my eye. Actually, I was crying anyway because I got beat up. Amy?
Yeah?
You're 26.
I am.
What's up?
Well, Adam, I want to tell you that you have a really great sense of humor.
Thank you.
And I don't care what anybody says. You're really cute.
Was that a compliment?
And not really, because I'd rather everyone think I was cute than Amy.
Right.
Well, everybody, you know what I mean?
It's like everyone says you're so cute, as opposed to like that. What was that girlfriend that said? Everyone said everyone thinks I'm crazy.
That was Esther Chiladenko, my first girlfriend, who says I decided to go out with you instead of your friend Chris. Everyone thinks I'm crazy, but I picked you.
Oh, that's not nice.
Yeah. Well, you just did the same thing, honey.
I don't care.
I don't think that was the same thing.
Oh, I don't care what everyone says. I think you're cute.
All right.
All right, anyway. I want to act out my fantasy of having a golden shower done to me, and I'm wondering how likely it is to catch anything, like any kind of STDs.
No, it's body fluid, so you don't want to expose it to...
Yeah, it's sterile.
Mucosal surface. There's a virus in there, potentially.
I'll give you the golden shower, and I'll toss in the mudslide at no additional charge. What do you say?
You're such a guy.
Yeah. What is that you get from that?
What do I get from it?
Yeah.
It's just a different way to be sexual.
No, it's not.
Yes, it is.
Something's wrong with you.
Oh, come on.
Something is so wrong with you.
Why?
You want a guy to do it or a girl?
A guy.
And how do you envision it? Are you lying in a tub or outside?
There's a beautiful set table with candelabra.
Well, I'm not going to do it in my bed or anything.
So you get in the bathroom?
Sure.
Now, are you guys in the shower?
Mm-hmm, probably.
Yeah, if you're in the shower, game on. Every guy's pulled that maneuver.
He's just marking his territory then.
Yeah. And do you lie down in the tub?
Yeah, or kneel down or something like that.
How boring or bad has sex gotten that you got to resort to other fluids?
Many other things to do besides just intercourse that are fun and interesting.
What if the guy blows a snot rocket at you? Is that cool?
Like that's not the same thing.
Just blows his nose in you?
No, because it's where it's coming out of is what's
I see.
Fun about it.
It's coming out of the phallus.
Exactly.
Yeah. What's up with you, though? Seriously. Something going on?
Oh, yeah.
Like what?
Former heroin addict?
No.
Something like that?
Not at
alcoholic,
all.
Pot, something.
No.
Please, tell us.
No drugs.
Yeah. When did you lose your virginity?
When I was 17.
Yeah. How's Dad?
How was it?
How is Daddy?
Oh, he's fine.
Get along with him fine?
Not really.
Why not?
Why not? I guess because, he wasn't really a good father.
Mm-hmm.
Just wasn't really there.
You taking notes?
Yeah. No physical abuse?
No.
No?
Nope.
No sexual?
Nope.
Just distant dad?
Just dad.
Mm. Any bisexuality?
Nope.
Lesbian?
Mm-mm.
Like a definite alcohol vibe.
Why would you think that?
Definite what?
Alcohol vibe.
Alcohol?
You do some drinking, Amy?
Not even. You guys are so far off base. It's funny, because you guys are right a lot of the time. But I think that you're barking up the wrong tree.
Yeah. You know the vibe I get with Amy? Angry.
Oh, yeah.
You got problems with guys?
No. Not at all.
You got a boyfriend you love him very much?
I don't have a boyfriend right now.
Oh, okay. What happened to the last one?
We grew apart.
What does that mean?
It means that I guess we had been together long enough and...
Okay. Listen, Drew. Forget it.
Well, that's fine. Let me just clarify, because I
want to get weed on, let her get weed on, and you can chalk that off your list. You done the anal?
Well, speaking of weed, I was going to go.
How about the anal?
I mean, it's not like I want to go do it professionally or anything.
Right. You don't want to be...
Know,
right. You want to check it off the list.
Yeah.
How about anal?
No.
No anal?
Nope. I've never done that.
Why not? Let me explain. Anal should be on the list before the golden shower.
Really?
Oh, yeah.
It seems so much more invasive.
Well, it is, but it's...
She's worried about STDs. That's certainly a better way to get STDs. Anal sex.
Through anal sex.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, but the amount of women that have tried anal is much greater than the amount of tried the golden shower.
Really?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, why don't you put anal on that list? All right?
I'll put it on with a question mark.
But let me ask a question about this. Okay. A substance. You smoking cigarettes?
Yeah, I smoke cigarettes.
A lot?
No.
You smoking pot?
I smoke a little pot.
How often are you smoking pot?
What?
How often do you smoke pot?
Maybe like once a month.
And your dad, you said he wasn't there as a father?
Mm-hmm.
Was he alcoholic?
No.
Was her mom alcoholic?
Maybe.
Yeah, I just get the definite...
She's cool.
I'm sure she is, but I just get... You should know. I deal with alcoholics every day in my clinical practice, and you got the definite vibe of the gene.
Do I?
Yeah. And do you think you have that sort of addictive...
Well, I could, but I definitely don't drink.
I understand, but it's the gene. Because you don't drink doesn't mean you're not alcoholic.
Well,
so...
And then these thrill-seeking sexual behaviors, this is alcoholic behavior.
It is.
Well, it's not an accident that I was going down that path fiercely, because I got that vibe with you very, very strongly. And, you know, that's fine. That's great. I mean, you need that in order to...
Good times.
Yeah.
We are.
You know you've got that potential. Stay away from substances.
All right. Once a month with the weed?
No.
All right. We'll take a break. We'll be back.
Hi, this is Tori Amos, and you're listening to Loveline with Adam Carolla and Dr. Drew.
There's old friend Tori. It is Loveline. I'm Adam. That's true, just like Tori said. Let's get back on the phone and see what we can do. John?
Yeah.
You're 27. What's up?
Yeah, I'm real sorry I had to lie to your operator. I hope she doesn't get me. I had to bet my life on this one.
Uh-oh.
I just wanted to call and talk to Dr. Drew because I'm 27. And
new policy.
The reason... I punched John out is because we have a slew of these. Whatever question I said,
it's not my question.
Isn't the question, and we've been just sort of gladly answering them anyway. But I realize the more we do that, the more calls we get that are bogus, or at least where the question is bogus and a different question, and we can't operate that way anymore.
Yeah.
And by the way, most of the time when you guys call, your follow-up question, the one that
is a better question,
is a better question. So just tell that to lovely Lauren, and she'll gladly put you on the air. All right, let's move forward. Holly?
Hi, how are you? This is my first time actually getting on the radio.
Great.
Good times, baby. What's up?
Well, I just wanted to let you know that I've been in a 2.5-year relationship, And I've done everything to be 100% there sexually for the guy I'm with. When I got a boob job, just looking great, very happy with myself. And he's been kind of stale, not really into me. And I had a situation come up where I got involved with my boss outside of work after we ended up quitting our jobs. And I went to a different job. He went to another one. And
restaurant business?
No, actually corporate business. And I'm 24 and he's 37.
Mm.
And it wasn't all the way. It was just flirting, playful, kissing, that sort of thing. But I feel really uncomfortable because, number one, the person that I'm with, I'm totally comfortable with. I want to be with him, but he hasn't given 100% to me. And I keep on hinting with the lingerie coming out there, and it's just very comfortable for him. And he tells me all the time that, you know, I'm pretty and he's happy to be with me, but I want it to be shown to me. I mean, when I come in there completely naked, I want full mask, not I'm watching TV or I'm in the bathroom. So I'm kind of...
And so this other guy, the guy you're having the affair with is giving you more attention.
Yeah, he's kind of catering. He's being romantic. He's giving me this outside attention, but it's not really what I want. I don't feel comfortable being with someone that old. I guess I have, it's not that much older, but I always had a thing that being with someone that much older than me is an issue. I've always been with people around my age.
Okay, let me just get this straight. How long have you been with your boyfriend?
2.5 years.
And how often do you have sex?
Once or twice a week. I rarely see him. It's been long distance for that long.
Okay. I'm going to talk to you I'm going to talk to Drew about you in front of you. Starts with the boob job, goes to the I wear lingerie and walk around naked. I'm not saying her boyfriend's a great guy, but Holly, you got some serious like male attention issues going on in your life, right?
I've always had that. I mean, I could give you my life story wrapped up. I came from a divorce. I went through crappy boyfriends, and now I'm with someone who actually, you know, treats me nice, but I'm not getting that outside attention, which I don't know how to stop it.
She's not getting the chaos, not getting the drama, what she's saying. So she got to spice it up with an affair. Nice.
But if he
she's not even interested in the guy she's having the affair with. She's just interested in the attention part of
that's
it.
That's right.
And you're not even having sex with the affair guy, right?
No. No, it's just a flirtation thing for me. The fact that he's stimulating.
It's just the fact that he's paying attention to you. And your boyfriend is not paying enough attention to you.
Yeah, that's part of it. The hard part is that I would think my boyfriend would be a little more receptive to the way that I am, especially when I've been throwing out hints. And I know with guys, you need to be more direct sometimes.
Okay, yeah. Don't throw out hints. Why don't you just communicate with him?
Yeah, be direct with him. Be specific.
If you walk into a room with no clothes on, you would think they would respond right away.
All right.
So that's kind of my issue there.
Hey, Holly?
Uh-huh.
You don't feel whole unless someone's trying to hump you?
No. I think part of it is I'm just not used to... The boyfriend I was with before wanted it every day, and now I'm with someone that's long distance, and when I see him only twice a week, and maybe one time out of that week, he doesn't want to do it because he's too tired. That is not a reason for me.
There's a lot to cover here. I don't know if we can broach it all.
I'm not sure. I understand what the question is.
I don't know what the question is, but I don't care what the question is. I'm getting a lot of vibe and chaos and stuff.
She's not interested in talking to us about it, though. I'm getting that clearly.
The one question that I did have that I mentioned was if what I'm trying to do is considered inappropriate. Or if this is something that...
Yes, it's inappropriate to be carrying on with another person when you're in a committed relationship. Yes, that's inappropriate. And it's inappropriate to manipulate and not be direct in your communication.
Communicate with the guy. If he does not rise to the occasion, then break up with him. But look into your issues of needing to be desired so badly.
I'm not even sure it's the chaos and the bad boys and all that stuff. She needs the drama.
And there's a male desire issue in her life. That's a big deal. I got the boob job. I get the lingerie.
Oh, yeah. Control and anger. And look, she sees the guy twice a week. They have sex both at least once of those times. The other time he's too tired.
Yeah, I don't
know. What is it he's not responding?
Jennifer?
Yes?
You're 24.
Yes.
What's up, real fast?
Well, I'm pregnant, and I've been dating this one guy for about 6 months, but he doesn't want to commit, mm-hmm. so we're more like friends with privileges. And I was with somebody else about 8 weeks ago, and I got pregnant. And I'm wondering if I should tell this other guy, the one I'm dating.
Well, you don't know this guy much. You just have a service agreement with him. Mm-hmm. You don't want to lie to him. You don't want to create any misconceptions about whose child this is. You got to tell him.
Okay.
You're going to have the child?
Yeah.
Adoption for the child?
No. No.
All right. You're just going to...
Yeah, I'm going to do it on my own.
Mm. Okay. So, all right.
But I should tell this guy?
Yeah. Well, why don't you just break it off with the guy? It doesn't sound like there's much going on with him.
Well, that'd be actually a healthier move.
And why don't you see about finding a more stable guy who can maybe be a father figure?
Yeah.
And what about the guy who got you pregnant?
He wants nothing to do with it, of course.
All right. Well, he's going to have to financially.
There you go.
Yeah.
Yeah, make sure he knows that.
Yeah.
Okay.
All right. All right, good times.
Yeah.
And we'll be back. Yeah. Well, there you go. Another fantabulous week of Loveline in the can. I want to thank Lauren for doing a great job on the phones, as well as Sarah, who's not here tonight, for doing a great job on the phones all week. I want to thank producer Ann, the feminine one, for rubbing her feminine stink on the show. Ann Anderson. Now, let me just give you kiddies a warning. The sheriff is back in town.
Indeed he is.
Anderson's going to be dropping in a few more of those Loveline drops, and not a moment too soon. So, there's one now. So, until next time, this is Adam Carolla for Dr. Drew saying mahalo.
Hey, Senor Smegma!
This has been Loveline. The opinions expressed on the show are not necessarily those of the staff, management, sponsors, or this station. The producer for Loveline is Ann Wilkins-Engel. Loveline is a presentation of Westwood One Entertainment.